Good morning and welcome to Korea Today live from Seoul.
With the fate of the Korean Inter-Korean Industrial Park hanging by a thread, the two Koreas will meet again for the sixth time in what many believe may be the last chance to make or break the deal.
In the meantime, Seoul and Washington met to discuss the military cost-sharing agreement on Wednesday. Details coming up in the headlines.
Is it a bird or is it a plane? No, it's an eagle eye watching your speed. We'll show it to you on Infant.
Now, this place brands itself as a gateway to the world, and it's one of the most busy places in Korea right now. I'll take you there in my story coming up.
Winners of the prestigious Red Dot Design Award were unveiled earlier this month. What does it mean to be the chosen design? We get a close-up on some of the winners. And another wonderful trip to Pochang, North Chola Province, where Andrew and Diana show you around a Dolmen site, a serene temple, and taste some of the regional delicacies on Korea Today, Thursday, July 25th, 2013.
From Arirang News, this is Korea Today.
Good morning, everyone. You're watching Korea Today on a Thursday morning.
And happy Thursday to everyone out there. Now, you hear this more often than not. The job market is tough, and even tougher is a position to become a government employee. And this Saturday, the open recruitment written exams to be a level 9 civil servant takes place in 17 cities and provincial locations across the peninsula. And it is said that the turnout is to be staggering.
That's right. The Ministry of Security and Public Administration says some 200,000 people have applied to take this test when they're only hiring 2,700 people, making the ratio, the competition ratio, 75 to 1. So fierce competition there. And the applicants will be tested on three required subjects, that is Korean, Korean history, and English. And to encourage high school graduates to apply and become a government employee, they've added three additional subjects they can choose from, which are math, science, and social science.
And of course, this is in line with President Park Geun-hye's concept of skills over specs. Mm. A lot of times specs were considered, but this kind of leaves out the many, many skilled people out there. So they're opening up new routes for these people with the skills so they can achieve their dreams.
So to the test takers out there, you have two more days to go. So do burn that midnight oil, and we do wish you the best of luck.
All right, good luck.
All right, we'll now go to Na Yeon-kyung for a look at the day's headlines.
Will the sixth time be the charm? The two Koreas will sit down in Kaesong on Thursday to once again discuss resuming operations at the joint industrial complex. All eyes are on whether Seoul and Pyongyang will be able to break out of the deadlock and produce some concrete results. South Korea wants the North to agree on safeguards that will prevent Pyongyang from abruptly halting operations like it did in April, while North Korea has insisted focusing solely on quickly resuming operations. Based on the last meeting held this past Monday, where Pyongyang showed a willingness to invite foreign companies to the complex, some pundits are hopeful Pyongyang may make a couple more concessions on Thursday. This is the sixth time the two Koreas will meet since negotiations first started early this month, 3 months after Pyongyang unilaterally pulled out its workers amid heightened inter-Korean tensions. The two main rival parties are still tangled up in the so-called NLL controversy, but they are now trying to move on. On Wednesday, the ruling Saenuri Party suggested having the prosecution focus on investigating where the missing 2007 Inter-Korean Summit transcript went, so that the two parties can work on determining whether late President Nom Wi-hyun had given up the maritime sea border to North Korea, as the ruling party claims.
It would be wise to come to a conclusion based on the overall situation, but we need to clearly declare our sovereignty over the NLL and bring the issue to an end.
Although the main opposition Democratic Party did agree on the need for an investigation, it also maintained its stance that the Saenuri Party was trying to water down allegations over the National Intelligence Service's involvement in meddling with last year's presidential election.
The truth behind all allegations against the spy agency should be clarified through the agreed parliamentary probe, and the investigation should shed light on all aspects of how the ruling party brought chaos to the nation's fundamentals.
Unable to narrow their differences, the two parties' floor leaders failed to hold a meeting on Wednesday, but political watchers say the two sides will keep talking to each other under the table in an attempt to make a breakthrough. A two-day bilateral meeting between Korea and the U.S. kicked off on Wednesday in Seoul to discuss how the two countries should split the military expenses of American troops stationed in Korea. This is the second time Seoul and Washington have sat down for this discussion. The first round of talks was held in Washington earlier this month, and this is what the two sides had to say going into Wednesday's meeting.
We look forward to having productive and in-depth discussions based on our previous meeting in Washington. I hope we can narrow our differences in the spirit of alliance.
All of us know what a serious task we have ahead of us, but I think it was a good start in Washington, and we look forward, like you do, to making more progress during these discussions in Seoul for our bilateral relationship and the alliance.
But unlike the friendly atmosphere on the surface, the two countries are said to have shown conflicting opinions, citing Washington's military budget cut and the worsened security situation on the Korean Peninsula. The U.S. reportedly asked Korea to pay nearly $900 million. That's about half of the total cost. Seoul has been paying about $800 million each year since their last cost-sharing agreement in 2009. Prosecutors have confiscated seven safety deposit boxes owned by family members of former President Chun Doo-hwan. Now, on Wednesday, investigators said they'd also seized three high-end residences owned by the former military dictator's second eldest son, Chun Jae-yong. They added that some 50 bank books, as well as gold and diamonds, were found in the confiscated deposit boxes. The seizures are, of course, part of the prosecutor's probe into the former president's hidden assets, which will go into paying the rest of the hundreds of millions of dollars worth of fines he owes the state. In 1997, former President Chun was sentenced to life imprisonment and a fine of nearly $200 million for staging a coup and accepting bribes during his rule.
And good morning, everyone. Picking a ride up off of Pyongyang's final headline, we'll go ahead and launch today's In Print with a look at the front page of 중앙일보 and how the newspaper covered this story. Now, its headline reads, Chun Jae-yong bought three Itaewon villas with Father Chun Doo-hwan's slush funds. And as you just heard, prosecutors are zoning in on those three villas or luxury condominiums, particularly as the date that Chun Doo-hwan's second son sold the two units on the 17th floor coincided with the day that the National Assembly approved the special Chun Doo-hwan law that freed prosecutors to probe the former president's family members as well. The article says that the Seoul Central District Prosecutor's Office confirmed yesterday that the funds to initially purchase those two 17th floor units came from bearer bonds purchased with the former president's slush funds. Now, prosecutors did question the 37-year-old woman who purchased the properties for some $2.7 million. They said she could be looking at a criminal charge if it is found that she signed a fake contract to help the younger Chun out. All right, and scooting over to Gyeongyang Shinmun now, an update on another big domestic story, the missing so-called NLL transcripts and the political heat-up surrounding it. Now, the headline reads, rival parties should agree to investigate missing transcript. And the headline does come from a press conference held by the chairman of the main opposition Democratic Party, Kim Han-gil, yesterday. He proposed to see the end of the ongoing bipartisan conflict through an impartial probe. probe to reveal the truth behind the disappearance of the 2007 summit talks transcripts. The probe, he said, should be handled by the same parliamentary team currently looking into the National Intelligence Service scandal, while the rest of the lawmakers should shift their focus on fairly competing to improve the lives of ordinary people. Now, Saenuri Party spokesperson Yoo Il-ho, meanwhile, responded by saying that the party welcomes a bipartisan effort, but disagreed on connecting the transcript probe with the probe on the nation's spy agency. And we'll leave that there and take a look at a front page image. It takes us to London, where the royal baby was introduced to the world on Tuesday, Korea time. The caption notes that the Duchess of Cambridge, Catherine, wore a polka-dotted dress reminiscent of Princess Diana's dress 31 years ago when her husband, Prince William, was introduced to the world in front of the same hospital. And leaving that there, let's scoot on over to our next newspaper, which has a close-up of the newborn, third in line, of course, to be king. And apparently, he is also yet to be adjusted to the paparazzi and the bright lights as well. But he appears to be still waving hello to the global media that had waited his arrival. Korea Today also sends our warmest wishes to George Alexander Louis. All right, scooting over to our next newspaper now, we return to Korea and we head to the roads with this story. Dongha-ilbo's headline reads, Eagle Eye Floats Above Highways. And we told you about the plans to test these unmanned aircrafts about a week or so ago. And Dongha-ilbo reports that indeed, if you saw a big blimp over your head while driving through the Gyeongbu Expressway yesterday, it was watching your speed, measuring at 12 meters and weighing in at 50 kilograms, the aircraft is carrying a high-resolution camera and it moves to the direction of its technician on the ground. Now, the use of the aircraft is said to be expanded later this month after the testing is concluded. And finally, let's take a look at today's business newspaper. The Korea Economic Daily has a story introduced by Young and Minjung at the top of the show as its top as well. The headline reads, Level 9 Civil Servant Exam Draws 200. For the 2,738 jobs up for grabs. That's a 78-to-1 ratio, and the inserted graph shows the growing number of applicants, particularly visible between the years of 2011 and 2013. The competition rate was higher, though, in 2010 and 2011, when it was at 82-to-1 and 94-to-1, respectively. The newspaper says this year's batch does mark the largest pool of applicants to date, and it characterizes the situation to the apparent lack of satisfactory jobs available in the private sector. We certainly wish all 200,000 the best. With that, we'll wrap your look at what's in print on this Thursday. Next up are your closing numbers from Wednesday's Market Action.
The weekend is nearing and we have an exhibition for you that you might be interested in checking out this weekend. It's a caricature exhibition.
All right, those are a lot of fun. I've never really had one drawn of me, but it was a tough 10 minutes trying to keep my kids still enough so they can actually get a picture drawn. In the end,
and,
they use their photos.
Right, they're not really impressed with the end results.
No.
They don't get the humor.
They really don't. Joining us is Im Yoon-hee, who went to check out an exhibition and to tell us more. Good morning.
Good morning, you guys. Yeah, so I went this year to the Global Caricature Exhibition at the Sejong Art Museum, and they had 213 pieces from artists from 16 different countries, and you know, it was a lot of fun to look at. You could definitely see who the popular people in Korea are. The theme of the event was 100 people Korean people love. So let's check out some of these caricatures.
Not the exact face that comes to mind when you think of President Park Geun-hye, or Angelina Jolie, or Kim Soo-hyun. But as caricatures aren't always the most realistic of drawings, they sure are fun to look at. These comical renditions of 100 people loved by Koreans is on display at the Sejong Art Museum until July 29th.
This year's 2013 character exhibition features 213 artists from 16 different countries.
Using anything from paint to markers, even computer graphics, caricaturists have captured the essence, so to say, of famous people from around the world. But they do more than bring attention to physical features. Caricaturists bring personalities to the pictures. An Cheol-soo's Lego-like body is seen holding a vaccine in one hand and a symbol of the National Assembly in the other. And this, with an oversized head and a grin to match it, is none other than worldwide famous Psy, donning his trademark Gangnam-style dance. He seems to be a popular character these days, both in real life and in this exhibition.
Among the pieces here, I think IU's caricature does the best at capturing her personality.
I really like this caricature because, unlike the bottom one, which has so many details, this one is drawn with a few simple lines and shapes, making it really unique.
But caricatures aren't exclusive to the rich and famous. Just outside the museum, there were lines of people waiting to get a caricature drawn by a professional. However, expect the bizarre, because the more abstract the drawing, the more fun everyone seems to have.
Caricatures are supposed to capture and exaggerate traits that a person already has. So even though I look funny, it's still a good caricature.
These might not be as intricate as the ones on display inside, but they prove to be plenty for a good laugh. And now it's my turn to see what I would look like in a caricature world.
Good job. Some faces are more plain than others, but some faces that you would think are plain have something interesting going on. And it depends, like, I'll go through a phase where I'm interested in teeth or different shapes and stuff in the face that you can see, find different possibilities. All right, here we go. Not too crazy, but it's 1, 2, 3, ta-da. Thank you.
That is supposed to be you, huh?
Do we look good? Yes.
You know, some caricatures are insulting and some are flattering, but yours, I think, somewhere in the middle.
I think the question that we all want to know is, did you pay the artist or punch the artist?
Well, I mean, the artist told me that the key to caricatures is in the interpretation. So they look for features and they sort of exaggerate it and they have fun with it. They
want to get you have a huge chin, according to that guy.
My interpretation was that Yuni had interesting teeth.
I mean, it's cute. You can see that the features are greatly exaggerated, but right. I wouldn't say this is anything really close to the beautiful.
My daughter looked at her picture and said, "This is not pretty. I'm not like this."
Exactly.
That's what kids react, how they react.
I guess I can't use it on my license this year.
So what else did you get to see there? Huh?
You know, so I met these artists, and I also met other artists who don't interpret, but they actually create. So cartoonists and animation artists. I got to meet them at the Seoul International Cartoon and Animation Festival this year, and you know, they have unlimited potential, infinite, you know, possibilities with their creation, their imagination. So kids love it, adults love it. It's a great time. So let's take a look at that.
The annual Seoul International Cartoon and Animation Festival is made for kids of all ages, including those stuck in grown-up bodies. This year's festival began on July 23rd at the Seoul Animation Center, and families have been coming from all over to take part in the celebration of Korea's cartoons and animations. Evidence of the growing popularity of Korean animation is seen in the streets around the Animation Center, and plans are being made to make the visual presence of Korean animation more permanent.
They're building a character street starting from Myeongdong Station to the Seoul Animation Center. Myeongdong has so many tourists, and the goal is to create a new sightseeing spot that will inform visitors about Korean animation.
But cartoons and animations have been created for hundreds of years before this festival was ever created. And today, cartoons are still used as a means of reaching across multiple generations.
Kids these days don't know about this cartoon because it's kind of old. But my daughter really enjoys cartoons, so I bought her to SickHalf this year to show her some of the things I used to read when I was young.
Many of the artists here are founding pillars of the modern Korean animation kingdom and are thus being recognized for their contributions. This year's SickHalf Award recipient Kim Dong-hwa is a legend among Korean cartoonists, known for his role in redefining the Korean comic.
Superhero comics are idealistic, making people feel hopeful. But we don't have superpowers, and when we read about normal people with normal abilities, we feel more secure about ourselves. This guy doesn't have superpowers, and he's living just fine, and so I This guy doesn't have superpowers, and he's living just fine, and so can I. That's my strength, making people feel comfortable in their own shoes.
Now, Korean animations have come a long way since we were kids, and I was very surprised and proud to see Korean names in some of my favorite animations that were from America or from other parts of the world. But in terms of the animation market here in Korea, where does it stand compared to other nations that's been in the animation market for some time?
You know, so historically, Japan kind of paved the road. The U.S. is a big producer of animation. Korea is actually third in the world of animation production. And Korea does a lot of outsourcing of animation. These days, they've actually been doing a lot more production. So instead of outsourcing their work, they'll do more in-house work, and then they keep it kind of in Korea. You know, Pororo, I'm sure you guys have heard of Pororo, is very well known internationally, and his or the success of Pororo is kind of leading the way of Korea's animation.
I remember I went to the festival last year, and the officials there and the experts and the cartoonists all said what they said was that Korea always lacked the content, coming up with the creative story and the creative character, but now it has started to do that, and Pororo, of course, is one good example.
It's just the beginning.
Yeah, exactly. It is more to come, though, more improvement. We have lot of room for improvement,
right? Yeah, and we are basically on our way, number three in the world. That is very good.
Yeah, so I met actually a few students from Hong Kong who are studying media, and they came to this event. They came to Korea specifically for this event so they can learn more about Korea's animation, because Korea is gaining a global recognition and a reputation for their animation industry.
That sounds good. I'll be looking forward to more cartoons and animations.
Thank you, Yuni.
Thank you for joining us. And speaking of animations, if you can make an animated character out of this
young
lady.
A caricature of Tami, that should be interesting. She would have the most beautiful eyes.
Exactly. All right, we'll get a check on the weather updates with Lee Dami joining us from Chungus Stream in Seoul.
Tami? Good morning.
Oh, well, thank you. That does sound interesting. I wonder what I would look like as a caricature. Well, good morning, everyone. Today, I am reporting live from Chungus Stream, located in Jongno-gu, Seoul. Yesterday, here in the nation's capital, we finally saw some sunlight. However, now that we're taking a break from the monsoon showers, it seems that the temperatures are out to haunt us. Here in Seoul, we'll start the day off fairly cool at about 23 degrees Celsius, but our highs will easily reach right above the 30s at about 31 degrees. Heat wave advisories are in effect over in the southeastern part of the nation, as well as Jeju Island. As for Daegu, it is under heat wave warning, so please try to stay cool if you are in those areas. Now, as for the conditions throughout the day here in Seoul, we'll see partly cloudy skies. This morning, we are seeing some fog as well with gusty winds, but nothing that will affect your sight on the roads. Now, the atmosphere is a bit unstable these days, so that means we may see signs of sporadic drizzles here in Seoul, the northern parts of Gyeonggi Province, and some areas in Gangwon Province as well. As for the monsoon front, it is expected to return this Sunday. So for those of you that are behind on your laundry, today seems like a good day to get started on that. Let's now take a look at the temperatures across the peninsula. It looks like our highs today will all reach out of the 30s. Daegu will skyrocket to 35, and Jeju Island will reach up to 32 degrees. Tomorrow, most of the nation will be seeing cloudy skies, but down in Jeju Island, there will be signs of some precipitation. That's all I have for today's weather forecast. I'm Lee Dami, Korea Today.
You're watching Korea Today. Do you like presents?
Of course you like presents. Of course,
we all love gifts, right? Especially when it comes in a beautiful box like this. And today we're going to talk about a new trend called subscription box or subscription commerce. What you do is you pay a fixed amount of money, and you get every month you get a new box. Mm-hmm. Filled with new and exciting things.
And what do you have
the thing
right
is that you don't know until you open what's inside. And we have a bottle of perfume. It's not only the beauty products, right, Yang?
Okay, so you basically get one of these boxes every month for a fixed subscription rate. And it's kind of a gift for yourself. And at the same time, you get to stay up to date with a lot of the new trends in makeup or cosmetics. But the great thing is, it doesn't stop just at makeup and cosmetics.
Mascara?
Because I don't think I'll need any of these. I'm just going to pass this one over, right back over to you.
All right, two boxes for me. Let's find out a little more in this next clip.
Shopping is part of our everyday lives with people making purchases several times a day. But recently, the way that people shop has been evolving. In the past, consumers only visited stores to buy goods. But more recently, online shopping is slowly becoming the norm. With a change in the way people shop, social commerce and subscription shopping methods are leading the trend. At an office in Gangnam, Seoul, Cho Ara receives a delivery on the same day every month. It's a secret box in some ways, since she doesn't know what's inside the package. The products inside are cosmetics, all of different kinds, shapes, and sizes.
I feel like I'm receiving a gift every month. Women often say it's a lot of fun to receive parcels like this. I get really excited when the delivery man drops by to give me my package.
What Cho receives is a popular subscription box. Customers can get this service by paying a fixed amount to the supplier for them to pick out and send over a variety of products. This is what's called subscription commerce.
Many office workers often find themselves too busy to shop. My friend recently introduced me to Mimi Box, so I subscribed to this service. So now it's great that I can receive the latest and most popular cosmetics every month.
Mimi Box launched its service last year in February and offers various beauty products. Currently, the company is raking in more than 100 million won in sales every month and leads the beauty subscription commerce market. The term subscription commerce comes from the regular concept of subscription in online electronic commerce. Since experts provide an array of quality products to their clients at lower prices, the consumers show high satisfaction.
I was asked to use a certain cosmetic sample, but the company brand didn't know who I was and what kind of products I often use. So of course they wouldn't be able to receive any feedback. Seeing such weak spots, I decided to improve such services and go online or go mobile with the service to increase customer satisfaction and offer benefits to both the customer and supplier.
And so, such unconventional subscription boxes provide a win-win situation for both the customer and manufacturer.
Nowadays, because there is an oversupply of goods out in the market, customers have become bored and tired with these latest products. That's why this unconventional social commerce, where consumers can experience new, unique, and diverse items, is becoming popular since there is that element of surprise every time they receive their packages.
One of the most popular subscription boxes are beauty products. This form of subscription commerce was first introduced in the US in April 2010 with beauty box subscriptions. And the same commerce platform was brought to Korea in June 2011. There were only about two or three of these beauty box subscription companies when the service was first introduced, but currently there are some 50 of them, with some expecting to see that number double by the end of this year. With the country's big companies also jumping on board the social commerce trend, the market has become one worth 30 billion won, or roughly $26 million, with some 1 million subscribers. Wanash is a company that delivers food packages to its customers, a similar concept to the beauty subscription commerce, but the business chose to enter the food industry and is receiving good reviews.
Most of our subscribers are very health conscious. Every month we change the name of our box. For example, if this month was all about healthy food, next month it could be about diet food. I think food subscription boxes have become an important means to reflect the current food trends. While we serve many different clients, it's true that we try to focus more on attracting female customers, and as a result, the majority of them are women.
Subscription boxes are constantly expanding and improving to fit the needs of diverse consumers. More and more subscription boxes for food, children, pet items, and coffee are also springing up. The rapid rise in Korea's subscription commerce market is attributed to word-of-mouth marketing. But as the service is still in its early stages, there is still much room for improvement. It'll be interesting to see how the service evolves in the future.
The Red Dot Design Award is given to some of the best products in furniture, machines, cars, and more. What does it mean to receive a Red Dot? And what kind of Korean products swept away some of these prestigious awards? Stay tuned for that.
Now, when you visit a foreign country for the first time, the first impression you get is usually from the place you arrive in which most cases is the airport. And with the summer peak vacation season in full swing, our Connie Lee went to Korea's Incheon International Airport to see how visitors were being received, right? So good morning, Connie, welcome.
Good morning, Hyunkyung. Well, yes, being at Incheon Airport made me want to catch a plane along with all those people taking off for vacation.
I second that.
Yes, now Incheon Airport, which is about an hour north of Seoul, was bustling with passengers eager to catch their flights out. And passengers eager to begin their trips here in Korea.
Yeah, and not to mention the Incheon International Airport has been recognized on a global level. It has just last month again won the name of being the world's top airport in the world.
Right, yes it did. I'll tell you more about that in just a bit, and just how much the globally recognized Incheon Airport plays a role in making the experience of traveling a bit more pleasant.
Feet are moving and bags are rolling. It's one of the busiest places in Korea this time of year. Introducing Incheon International Airport, which is expecting a record-breaking number of passengers in the coming weeks.
Incheon International Airport is at its busiest from July 20th until August 18th. So we've expanded our facilities and increased the numbers of employees here to prepare the heavy influx of passengers during this peak season. Specifically, on August 4th, we expect 148,000 passengers, which would be an all-time single-day record.
During the summer peak season, the airport is expecting nearly a 6% increase in passengers compared to last year. So officials are prepared. They beefed up manpower at the airport and are opening check-in counters 30 minutes earlier than usual. But even without taking these special preparations into account, Incheon Airport stands out for its efficient, high-tech facilities. It's the best airport in the world, literally. For the eighth consecutive year, Incheon Airport was named the best airport out of more than 1,700 airports worldwide in two different categories, Best Airport in the Asia-Pacific region and Best Airport by size. No wonder visitors rarely leave disappointed.
I have not traveled here before. Very pleasantly surprised. It's a beautiful airport, very clean. Everyone's been friendly. The signage is great, easy to get around.
Even the convenient process of getting to the airport and leaving it is a customer fave, thanks to an airport bus service.
I'm actually waiting for a bus. There's my bus right there, actually, just pulled up. Every time I fly here, I always get the bus over a taxi because it's cheaper and more efficient.
It's very convenient because it's coming very often and you have a direct connection to the hotels, which is very convenient in the sense.
But passengers shouldn't rush too quickly to leave the airport.
There's a lot Incheon Airport has to offer to passengers. We use state-of-the-art technology throughout the airport, and the departure and arrival process here is 3 times faster on average than other airports worldwide. Passengers can actually afford to enjoy leisure activities here.
The airport even boasts a movie theater, which is right next to a skating rink, which is not too far from a stage for musical performances for guests to enjoy.
This is one of the airport's main attractions, its concert series, which features different musical performances every single day, 365 days a year.
But for all of its high-tech facilities and its modern feel, Incheon also has traditional touches mixed in here and there.
We were looking for a place to rest for a little, and after browsing through the airport, we saw this area, and it looked very pretty with traditional Korean elements. We're enjoying the view from here.
One of the airport's newest attractions is this Cultural Heritage Avenue, featuring traditional Korean-style deco and various shows and performances that allow guests to get a little taste of ancient Korea.
It's very interesting for us to know about the culture of Korea, and we liked it very much. It was a pleasure to be with the royal family.
So even though passengers during this summer season rush may be looking forward to getting out of the airport, Incheon International Airport is still able to make an impression on those who pass through.
You know, it almost looks like a department store to me.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Now, for people who've been to the airport, they're not surprised that it actually won those many awards, and it is top class. Now, a few facts and figures on the airport. It's actually only 12 years old, so it hasn't been that long since it's been operating. And it carries nearly 90 airliners, which go to about 183 different cities worldwide. And just last year alone, it had 38 million passengers pass through, which is actually up from 35 million from the year earlier. Now, the airport has the ninth highest international passenger volume, and because the airport is expecting more passengers in the future, they are actually planning to expand the airport by 2017. Hmm. Now, the immediate plan is to raise the number of transfer passengers actually to 10 million starting in 2015. And of course, with that many passengers coming in and out of the airport, you need the staff. And so Incheon Airport has 35,000 people who work there right now.
And because it has a lot of passengers, you know, passing by and the transfer of visitors as well, it could be a little bit inconvenient, but I mean, from your report, you can see that it's not at all, right?
Right, so there is a big rush at Incheon Airport and at Gimpo Airport right now because it is peak season. But if travelers in Korea want an even faster check-in process, they can go to what's called a city airport terminal, which is in Seoul. Uh-huh. So Incheon Airport and Gimpo Airport, which acts as a hub for domestic flights here in Korea, have partnerships with two city airport terminals in Seoul, where passengers can check in their luggage and get their tickets before even getting to the main airports. Now, here's video of the one in Gangnam in southern Seoul. Mm-hmm. At this location, there are 9 different airlines, including Korean Air and Singapore Airlines, that support the system. So it's pretty convenient, and you can see here there's not that much traffic here.
Yeah, not a lot of people know about this place.
During the peak vacation season, like we are in right now, Incheon and Gimpo airports are very crowded, and checking in can take a while. But here at the city airport terminal, passengers can check in their bags and go through immigration process in 10 minutes.
So in 10 minutes, he says. So the check-in process and immigration process is the same here as it would be at the main airports. And right after you do all of that, you can take a bus from there, and the bus leaves every 10 minutes to Incheon Airport, and to Gimpo Airport it leaves every 30 minutes. So it's actually very convenient and easy
to do. Yeah, exactly. And the second one that you mentioned is in Seoul Station, right?
Yes, it's in Seoul Station, and that works the same way. Not as many airlines there, but you can take the train straight to Incheon, or there are different stops, and you can actually get to Incheon in less than 50 minutes, so about 40-ish minutes. And so airport officials do advise that passengers look into the city airport terminals to avoid the rush during this peak summer season.
Mm-hmm. And we should do that planning our vacations too, right?
Right, right.
hopefully. All right, thank you very much, Connie, for joining me and telling us about the Incheon International Airport today.
Yeah, you're welcome.
And staying on the topic of traveling, now our Andrew and Diana went to Gochang in North Jeolla province to immerse themselves in Korea's culture and beauty. They toured around an Asian dolmen site, a beautiful temple, and enjoyed some of Gochang's best dishes. So if you want to find out more, stay tuned. All right, it's time for Design Korea, and today we're going to talk about a red dot that is not just a red dot. And joining us for this is a new guest.
All right, joining us is Lee Pro-ni, graphic designer, illustrator, and lecturer. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the show.
Thank you.
So you are an illustrator and also a graphic artist. You work with different firms and companies on and consult them on their visual identity design exhibitions. Mm-hmm. What do you have for us today?
Okay, today I want to talk about the globally recognized Red Dot Design Awards. The awards are given out to
some of the best designs
out there,
right?
Right, the excellent designs internationally, and the winners were announced recently. Mm-hmm. Let's take a look at some of the examples from the awards.
New, fascinating products are pouring into the marketplace every day, and with their innovative and unusual designs, they are captivating the hearts and attention of many consumers.
I tend to look at the designs. I'll buy something if I like how it looks and will use it often.
I look at the design because usually the design, like if you wear it, it defines who you are, so I think I should just look at design most of the time.
Along with Germany's IF and the US's IDEA, the Red Dot Design Award is recognized as one of the most famous design awards. The Red Dot Design Award started back in 1955, and every year there are some 6,000 submissions from 50 different countries, making it the world's largest product design exchange center. The award is divided into three different categories: product design, communication design, and concept design, focusing on up-and-coming creative talents and their cutting-edge designs. The winning products are displayed in different online and offline museums in Germany and Singapore, and also featured in the award's annual almanac. Also, the winners are given the special right to use the Red Dot Design Award's official logo on their products. At this internationally competitive award, Korean companies have been receiving positive feedback and ratings. Following the last few years of successful awards, many Korean products have once again swept up awards this year, especially in the communication design category, where designs with substantial and effective communications characteristics with consumers are noted. And out of the awardees, Paris Baguette walked away with three prizes. This adorable paper cup in the shop is one of the winners, celebrated for its innovative personified design. The name of this cup is Parisian Cup and was made to easily convey the Paris Baguette's brand name, and customers are also expressing their likes to this design.
At first, I didn't really notice anything special about this cup, but when my friend told me that there are eyes here, I thought it was really cute, and the design is one of a kind.
Usually, I tend to just throw away the to-go cups, but this one, I want to take it home and use it once more because the design is so unique.
This year's Red Dot Design Award officially recognized some great designs like the Parisian Cup, the coffee bean-imaged Kopi, and the ingeniously designed restaurant, Street.
As the latest design trend is coming up with more practical but friendly looks, our company has adopted to this new movement. Consequently, we've made it our priority to build eccentric and creative designs that can draw closeness and familiarity from consumers. Fortunately, we've been receiving great feedback, and we were able to win the Red Dot Design Award this year.
Korean product designs were highly noted for their creative, innovative yet practical designs this year at the Red Dot Design Award. And with these great results, we'll look forward to more fearless advancements in the design world for the years to come.
So most of the Korean products received awards in the communication category in this one too. But the idea, I guess, is that the design is communicating with you. But this is not really talking to me. What is this communication category? Tell us about this.
I think it's a good example that shows the relationship between the brand, the Paris Baguette, and the customer and the product. Mm. Because you go to the bakery and you take out the coffee, mm-hmm. and you don't just take out the coffee cup and forget about it. It's cute, and you can sort of interact with it because it's
talk to it.
Yeah,
yeah. It's like wearing a hat and a jacket or something. You can play with
it. Play with it. Yes.
Remember more because it's different from every other cups in the streets from different chains.
You're right.
So it talks to you, and also. It's ergonomically functioning because the lid is curved and it fits better on the lid.
I see. Okay.
I guess you can mix and match also if you can give me your lid. We can put that on there, customize it, right? But there's always a dominating trend when it comes to these awards. Mm-hmm. And this year's Red Dot Design Awards, what was the dominating trend?
Well, one thing I found interesting was one of the new juries was the shoe designer, do you know, Jimmy Choo?
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm.
So that sort of added some glamour to the award.
She was one of the judges, you mean?
Yeah. That was funny. And I think one of the trends was a lot of products and designs were focusing on the well-being of the users, the humans, and also the emotional well-being, mm-hmm. not just the functions of the product, but how we feel about them.
And
a lot of the older generation Koreans and people around the world, they might have chosen substance over style, but now when you have the style that comes with the substance, then you can't ask for anything more, right?
It's both important.
Right. And you're a graphic designer too. Yeah. Maybe one day you can win this Red Dot Award too.
Hopefully.
And you can join us then too.
I look forward to it.
All right. Thank you for your time this morning.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
And coming up next is your sports updates with Jason Lee. But first on Korea Today.
Cup that can do everything. If only it could score goals for Korea's soccer team, that could really help out. You know, when Korea settled for a scoreless draw against Australia in Hong Myung-bo's debut as head coach of the national team, the critics were actually quiet, citing the fact that Korea completely dominated the game, and in fairness, Australia is ranked ahead of Korea. Anything but a win against 100-ranked China clearly would not go unnoticed this time. But you know what? It was actually the same result again, as Korea couldn't score against China as well. Korea again dominated the game, although probably not as convincingly as they did against Australia, where it seemed like the Aussies were probably playing like a man down. So Dong-hyun had the most opportunities for Korea to score, but simply could not finish. Korea quite often made Chinese keeper Jung Chung look very good. Now, as for Korea's women's team, they were coming off a 2-1 loss to North Korea, who came back for the win over the weekend. So clearly the Korean women would need a better effort and certainly more focus in their next game against China, which also took place yesterday. But history would repeat itself as Korea would fall again 2-1, this time to China, leaving Korea as the only winless team among the four teams in the round robin. Korea's final game will come Saturday, 8 p.m. against Japan. Meanwhile, Korea's men also play Japan in their final game at 8 p.m., but that'll be on Sunday instead of Saturday. Both games will be played at Seoul's sports complex over in Chamsil. It was a good day to be a Korean soccer player in the Bundesliga. Guja Chhar scored his first goal of the preseason for new old team as Wolfsburg beat Austrian second division side SCR Altach 3-1. Who scored the opening goal in the 7th minute for Wolfsburg, whom he actually returns to after spending the last season and a half on loan to Augsburg. Meanwhile, Son Heung-min scored his third goal of the preseason, but it came in a 2-1 loss to second division Belgium side KAS Weppen. Son started the game after entering the previous game off the bench with his new team Leverkusen, so clearly at least a step in the right direction for Son. And that is your look at sports. Remember to eat healthy and get some exercise today.
All right, thank you, Jason. Andrew and Diana's second trip to Gochang. Let's follow them right now.
Diana and I are out on a trip to the cultural heritage city of Gochang. From exciting pansori experiences here, to digging up clams from the region's pristine mudflats.
You got one.
I got one, Diana. Ta-da-da! I found one!
The two of us were busy making unforgettable memories in this beautiful city. While enjoying some mudflat fun, it was already time for dinner, so with our empty stomachs, we visited a restaurant that serves one of the region's specialties, the Pungjong eel. For Diana, this is her first time seeing the fish. But she courageously holds up the live eel and even takes a picture with it. Diana is on a mission to make some flavor-roasted eel dish for me. The long wait is definitely worth it because the taste of the well-roasted eel is priceless. With this, I'm fully recharged from summer exhaustion as we finish up our delicious dinner. Our first day here in Gochang also comes to an end. During the early hours on our second day, we visit one of Korea's most scenic Buddhist temples, Sonnunsa, a famous tourist stop. It's surrounded by natural monument camellia trees and other famous cultural relics. One of the best attractions of visiting Sonnunsa is being able to enjoy tea with the temple's breathtaking view.
녹차 중에 이거는 황차라 그래서 황차 발효차라고 이야기해요.
The tea grown in the tea field nearby is one of the three regional specialties. Diana seems a bit nervous. In the temple's solemn and holy atmosphere, such quietness and calmness is difficult for a little girl bundled with energy. Yet, she tries to sit cross-legged on the floor. That may be just a bit too much for her, though. This serene tea tasting on a hot summer's day is definitely an experience not to miss.
This green tea is obviously of a higher quality than I've usually had, because I haven't had tea in a temple before.
We continued our journey and arrived at this Dosalam statue of Buddha engraved on a large rock. This Mayabul was designated treasure number 1,200, and its enormous size is mesmerizing. A lot of visitors come here to make their wishes. After our little healing session, we make our way to the Dolmen Museum. Here, there are detailed replicas of how people lived during the prehistoric times. Since we just learned a bit about the history of the dolmens at the museum, now it's time to see these ancient relics with our own eyes, as Gochang is known for having the largest group of dolmens in Asia.
Ah, there they are, Diana. You see? Those are the graves. Remember the graves? Remember we picked up that rock?
Yeah.
And we put it on top? Under there are the graves. Isn't that fantastic?
Whoa. Differently sized and shaped dolmen rocks immediately catch our attention.
So I've never seen this kind of thing before, and it makes me very curious and fascinated.
Is that all right?
Both Diane and I are awed by the gravity and greatness of these dolmens. After our mystical dolmen experience, we came to the Bukbunja Research Center. Bukbunja, also known as wild black raspberries, is another regional specialty. Gochang Bukbunjas are known for their taste since they grow with the wind from the West Sea.
Bukbunja가 들어있는 Bukbunja 초콜릿을 만들어 드릴 거예요.
What's this important ingredient?
무슨 맛이에요?
Aha! This is bokbonja powder, finely ground up from dried bokbonja.
That's from the berry, right? Black raspberry.
After mixing the bokbonja powder into the heated chocolate, you place the mixture into the mold and just wait. After a little bit of waiting, it's time to try out the bokbonja chocolate. It looks like Diana is just as eager as me to try the sweet. She can't wait to get her little fingers on the chocolate. Now it's my turn to try out the chocolate.
It's not overpowering. I thought it would be overpowering. It would be too much berry taste, but it's not overpowering. It mixes very well with it.
Would the cameraman like one? Would you like one?
And this one is for Diana's mom.
But let's give one of these boxes of chocolates to mommy. How about that, eh?
Yours.
And then some to me? So I can take it home? How about that?
Every inch of gochujang is alive with beauty and tasty treats. So come on down to this natural and historic city to experience everything it has to offer.
Right now I have this huge craving for bokbonja chocolate.
That looks like a healing trip, eh?
Yeah. Hey. Right. Who would have ever thought the mix would work well, right?
Right. All right, that brings us to the end of this edition of Korea Today.
Have a great day and we'll see you back here tomorrow at 7 a.m.
Thanks for watching. Bye-bye.